In this part of the series, we're going to take a look at picture settings. If you're using the Mac, you can get to it by clicking this button right over here, and you'll get a picture settings window. If you are on Windows, it's going to look something like this instead. You've got all these tabs towards the bottom, and picture is where you're going to access the options. They're essentially the same between Windows and the Mac. It just looks a little bit different. Now, one nice thing when you're using the Mac is you're going to be able to hit this preview button here, and you're going to get kind of a preview window. So you can see, as we start messing with some of these options, you'll be able to see kind of live how it's going to affect your video. As opposed to Windows, the way things are going to work is, to see what you've kind of changed, you're going to have to hit preview, and then it's going to have to generate a preview, and it'll probably have to play it back in VLC. So just keep note that if you're using Windows, and you kind of make some changes, you're going to have to, you know, generate this preview and kind of watch, and then you know, hopefully you'll have an idea as to what exactly you changed and how everything turned out. But we're just going to use the Mac interface for now because it makes everything a lot easier. So we'll start with anamorphic and kind of what this means and you know, what it does. To start off, first of all, we're going to be using anamorphic strict most of the time, just because what happens is we've got basically pixels of information here, right? Like basically all the detail here, you know, ignoring these black bars for a moment. When you keep anamorphic at strict, you pretty much always keep all of that detail. When you're using loose, sometimes you can get some resizing going on, and we'll get into that in a bit. But anamorphic strict is what we usually use. And I'm going to just quickly go over what all these things mean, in case you've kind of been, you know, lost when you looked at the word anamorphic and thought, well, what's that all about? So source, first of all, is talking about our source resolution, so the file that we loaded into Handbrake. In this case, it came from a file on the hard drive, which came from a DVD, and this was the source resolution that was stored in this file. Output is talking about, basically, when we spit out a new file in Handbrake, what the resolution is going to be there. And you can see right now it's the same as the source. We're going to retain all of this detail here, and we're going to retain these black bars the way we've got everything set up right now. We'll be changing that later. But just note that right now it's the same as the source. And anamorphic, on the other hand, is sometimes a little bit tougher to wrap your head around, so I'm going to try and explain it in a way that hopefully makes sense to you. So what anamorphic does, even though we've got kind of 720 pixels wide, anamorphic is a little flag built into the video that says, even though you've only got those 720 pixels to work with, stretch it out so it looks as though we've got 853 pixels wide on the screen. And just to kind of show you what I'm talking about there, I'm going to turn anamorphic off for a moment and just watch the picture, and you'll see everything just kind of squished a little bit, right? The height didn't change, but, you know, the width just kind of squished. And this is the way that the video was actually stored on the DVD. What they did was, it was a widescreen video, they kind of squished it down so it would fit onto the DVD, and then they set that little anamorphic flag that says, things aren't going to look right, so, you know, stretch it out. And, of course, they knew exactly what numbers to be plunking in for that, but we'll go into that a little bit later. But in any case, hopefully that helps you kind of wrap your head around this concept of anamorphic. And it's important to note that it doesn't always mean to stretch things out, sometimes it means to squish them, but in any case, when you see this anamorphic, chances are, whatever pixels were stored are kind of being manipulated to be, you know, stretched or squished. So by default, a lot of times when you pop into Handbrake, it starts off with a setting of anamorphic loose. And we'll look at that, and you'll see I just changed this to loose, and nothing here actually changed. Loose, and with a modulus of 2, is almost exactly the same as anamorphic strict. There's actually pretty much no difference at all, except that every once in a while when you load a file in, especially if you've loaded a preset, what can happen is for some strange reason you'll find that, you know, your width is down a little bit, maybe because this modulus was set to something other than 2. And then you'll go to encode your videos and you'll kind of be missing a little bit of detail there. I mean, you won't necessarily notice it when you're watching it, but, you know, that detail will be, you know, will be kind of missing, and that kind of bugs some people, so keeping things at anamorphic strict is kind of the safe way to go most of the time. Now you might wonder, what about if I have material that wasn't anamorphic, right? Which, if you recorded something on your computer, or a lot of times from a video camera, you won't have that anamorphic flag. Another example is a Blu-ray. Blu-rays don't use those anamorphic flags. What you can do is actually just leave anamorphic at strict anyway, and things will end up being okay. And I'll just show you an example of that by pulling this out of the way. And I'm going to pull in the picture settings window from a Blu-ray. So this was a 1080p Blu-ray, you can see that 1080 is the height. And Blu-rays don't actually store that anamorphic flag. But what happens when I set this to strict is that Handbrake takes a look and says, okay, there wasn't an anamorphic flag, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to make one up, but I'm just going to make it the same size as the output. So there's actually not going to be any sort of a change, right? There's not going to be any extra squishing or stretching going on. Everything will be okay. So you might wonder, well, should I maybe set things to none if I know there isn't an anamorphic flag, you know, and then set it to strict if I know that there is? You could do that, but the downside you're going to run into is you'll get into the habit sometimes of doing a bunch of Blu-rays, you'll set it at none, and then you'll go and encode a DVD, and you'll go to watch it after, and things won't look right, and you'll realize, oh no, I forgot to set anamorphic. So setting it to strict is kind of a good practice to get into, because when you do it all the time, things will just about always look right. 99% of the time, everything's going to look just fine, and you're not going to run into any headaches. And that's one less setting you'll kind of have to worry about if you just keep setting it to strict. You can kind of focus on worrying about all these other options in Handbrake, and you won't have to worry as much here. So let's take a look at anamorphic none. We already kind of briefly saw that, and as we saw here, it kind of squishes everything. When might you want to use anamorphic none? Well, if your material wasn't anamorphic and you don't want Handbrake adding a little anamorphic flag there for you, you could use anamorphic none. But in the case of a video like this that originally was anamorphic, we've got a problem. Everything's going to look a little bit squished. So what you could do here is you could select keep aspect ratio, and you're going to see it's going to fix the way the image looks. Everything will kind of look correct, but everything got smaller. And you might wonder, well, why did everything just get smaller? That's probably not so good. And you'd be right to notice that. What happened here? Remember, our source was 720 by 480. Our output now is 720 by 404. We just lost some pixels here. We've got, instead of 480, we've got 404. What Handbrake did, instead of stretching out the 720 to be 853, it shrunk down the height to be 404. And we actually kind of lost those pixels of information. Not that we necessarily completely lost it and they just went out into space, but Handbrake had to kind of resize things, and you kind of lose detail anytime that happens. So you really want to avoid doing that. Just setting anamorphic to strict all the time is usually going to serve you well. So let's look at the next option here, anamorphic loose, which we already talked about a little bit. But when might you want to use anamorphic loose? Well, a great time to use anamorphic loose is if you want to resize a video. And this one's, you know, it came from a DVD, and we might necessarily want to, might not want to make this a whole lot smaller. But if we did, what we could do here is just start pressing down on the width, and the height is automatically going to start moving down too. So we don't have to worry that maybe we, you know, made the width smaller, but we, you know, forgot to make the height small enough. Everything will kind of stay in the proper aspect ratio so that everything will look, you know, kind of correct. Now you might take a look at this modulus area and see it's set to modulus 2 and wonder what this setting does. This, if I change this to 16, what this is going to do is this is going to make sure the width is divisible by 16 and the height is divisible by 16. So you might wonder, well, why does that matter? The truth is it used to matter because the encoder that Handbrake uses really liked when things were divisible by 16 because of all the fancy math it does to encode your videos, but that's not really the case anymore. One downside if you use 16, and I'm actually going to pull this out of the way, and pull back in that Blu-ray, is if we set this to anamorphic loose and we set this to 16, it's going to make sure that these are both divisible by 16, right? But if you take a look at our output now, we just kind of lost 8 pixels there, right? We had, you know, 1920 by 1080, and now we've got 1920 by 1072. To make this height divisible by 16, it had to kind of shave off 8 pixels. And again, these aren't pixels that just kind of, you know, vaporized and went into nowhere, but it kind of had to resize things. And as we mentioned before, you generally want to avoid resizing things unnecessarily because you lose a little bit of quality. What Handbrake also did in this case was it kind of modified this anamorphic flag so that everything's going to look correct if we actually, you know, were to create this file. That's the nice thing about anamorphic, you know, whether you're using strict or loose, everything will usually kind of look correct, but we still kind of lost that little bit of information. So generally try to avoid anamorphic loose unless you're trying to resize, but if you resize something, try and stick with modulus 2. So you can use 16 to zip something down, but then say I wanted this to become a 720p video, I might bring it close, so there we go, and then I might set this to anamorphic 2, or sorry, modulus 2, just to make sure that it's not kind of, you know, removing some, you know, extra pixels unnecessarily. We're kind of keeping everything that we can. So finally, let's take a look at Anamorphic Custom. And what's this about? Well, everything just got a little bit confusing here. We'll actually pull this out of the way and pull back our DVD just because this is going to kind of display Anamorphic Custom a little bit better for us. I'll just set this strict first to get everything looking back the way it was. And now we'll go to Custom. So when might you want to use Custom? Well, for some reason you had to manipulate the width and the height that are actually stored on the file, like stored in the file. You could do that here while keeping things at anamorphic, as opposed to, you know, if you're using none and kind of trying to do the same thing. But the other thing that custom will let you do is change the aspect ratio as you see it on the screen. This anamorphic flag here that says basically to stretch things out or squish them. And you might wonder why you'd ever want to do that, and normally you wouldn't, but every once in a while somebody might send you maybe a video from their, you know, a vacation they went on that they filmed on their camera, and it turned out that their camera was pretty buggy and maybe things looked something like this. So you go to play the video and you're like, oh gee, something wrong happened. A precious memory that they've got, or that they thought they had, is going to be kind of gone forever as far as a video is concerned. What you can do in Anamorphic Custom is you can play with this PAR width, and that stands for pixel aspect ratio. And by increasing this, you can kind of stretch things out, and by decreasing it, you can kind of squish them back down. So in this case, if we received a video like this and we were going to try and fix it, we might just trial and error. So, okay, well, it was, you know, at 10, we'll try 20. Oh, that made it a little bit better. Let's try, you know, maybe 50. Oh, things just got way too wide. And in this case, eventually we'd figure out that, oh, 32 looks pretty much perfect. Now you might wonder about this display width and PAR height. Generally, you don't want to kind of mess with those just because a whole bunch of other numbers can start changing on you. There are a couple little bugs in Handbrake here that'll mess things up for you. So I might be fine tuning something here and then I go and click here and you're going to watch as soon as I even click here, as soon as I let go of the mouse button. Okay, in that case, it didn't cause problems. There we go. Okay, it just changed all these numbers on me, and it just causes a big headache. So try and avoid playing with the other stuff. Just focus on this PAR width section until you get things looking correct. Now, one other thing to note is that when I have kind of played with this PAR width and changed things, it doesn't actually change what the size of the file is going to be. If you can look here and see, the file size is going to be the same. Like, we've got the same resolutions actually stored, right? All we've done is we've kind of messed with this anamorphic section to tell the video player to stretch things out or to squish things down when it's playing them back, but we're not actually storing any information. So even though you might see these numbers and say, oh wow, 1600, that's going to be a really huge video file, no, it's going to be exactly the same as it was before, because by playing with this number here, we've only affected the way things are going to look, not the way that things are stored. Now, going back to the Windows side of things for a second, just in case you've been following along using the Windows side and wondering kind of what's going on, because things aren't looking quite the same. Unfortunately, in the Windows part of things, playing with these values here doesn't always work correctly. You'll run a preview, you'll change this, and you'll say, hey, things should have been wider, but, you know, I did a preview and they didn't actually change. Those are some kind of bugs that are in the Windows version, and I think probably because so few people actually use these settings, it's probably not something on the priority list. But in any case, while custom might cause some hiccups for you on the Windows version, the other ones generally kind of work as you would expect. The only downside being that when you make a change here, you have to generate a brand new preview, and that way is the only way you're going to see the changes that you made, as opposed to when you're using the Mac. You can just see things as you're kind of changing them, right? So you make a tiny change, you see what's going to happen right away, and there's not going to be a big deal. So finally, let's look at this cropping section and figure out what that's all about. Well, like I had said before, we've got these black bars on the top and the bottom and the left and the right, and normally you wouldn't want to encode these into your new video file. There are a couple reasons for this. First of all, it just wastes space, right? We've got, 720 pixels by 480. It's going to have to save all of those, but a lot of that is just useless black bars, right? On the top, the bottom, a tiny one on the left, and a tiny one on the right. So it's a good idea to get rid of those for that reason. Another reason that it's nice to get rid of those is if I were playing this back on a computer, and I had it maybe in a window in the top, you know, in the top corner of the screen while I was doing some email or some other work, I mean, those black bars are taking up valuable desktop space. One more reason that it might be a good idea to get rid of these is if I were trying to play this on an ultra-widescreen TV and I have encoded black bars, that's kind of added information that the TV thinks is part of the picture, right? So if it's got to add its own black bars, this might kind of complicate things there, right? I might end up with extra black bars on the left that I didn't have originally, you know, or just even thicker black bars on the top and bottom, and it just creates kind of a big mess. So generally we want to cut those off, and a nice easy way to cut those off is to set cropping to automatic. And when you do that, Handbrake will look for what it thinks are kind of those, you know, wasteful black bars, and it'll chop them off for you and automatically plug in numbers here. Now Handbrake gets this right most of the time, but sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes it'll cut off a little bit too much, or sometimes it won't cut off enough. In this case, you can maybe see a little bit that, well, we've still got a little bit of extra black here that, you know, if we were really picky, we might want to cut off. And in that case, we might set this to custom and then just kind of adjust until we had things exactly the way we wanted. By the other token, if it cut off too much, we can just start bumping down these values and we'll see some of the picture is restored. So one final thing that you could use custom for, but I strongly recommend against, is let's say we had a widescreen video and we wanted to do a really hack way of turning it into a full screen video. Well, we could just chop off a whole bunch from the left, and we could chop off a whole bunch from the right, and we'd end up with something kind of resembling a full screen video. And going the other way, if you had something that was full screen and you wanted to do a really hack way of making it widescreen, you could chop off a bunch of stuff from the top and chop off a bunch of stuff from the bottom. But you usually don't want to do this because you're literally chopping off information. This is information that you're kind of vaporizing, right? And some of this information could be somebody's head, or it could be, you know, somebody who is standing off to the left or somebody who is standing off to the right. So I strongly recommend against using cropping for that purpose. But hey, if you're really intent on making your full screen video look widescreen, I mean, there's nothing I can do to stop you. Just beware that not everybody else may enjoy the video as much as you. A final note here: you'll notice that even though we have anamorphic set to strict, our output number has gone down. That's just because we have cropped things, and that actually makes sense, right? If I set this back to automatic, you know, we had 720 pixels wide. Well, if we subtract the two little black bars we chopped off from the left and the two from the right, well, that makes sense that now we're at 716. And by the same token, we chopped off a whole bunch of black from the top and the bottom, right? 56 and 60. Well, if you take 56 and 60, you know, and you subtract them from 480, well, you're going to get 364. So that actually makes sense. So don't get into the habit. Some people will, you know, kind of remember the part where it's, well, I want my output to be the same as the source. I don't want to kind of lose any information, right? And they'll go ahead and then they'll try and manually start, you know, adding stuff back. But you don't want to do that when you've actually kind of cropped off these black bars, because now if we start manually forcing our output back up, what's going to happen is we're kind of resizing things, right, from the original back to something wider. We're taking kind of the original image and we're enlarging it to fit a larger frame, and we're not getting any extra quality by doing that. We're just taking up extra file size, and we're kind of actually losing a bit of resolution or some detail in the process. So generally, if you set anamorphic to strict and you've done some cropping and your output number is different than the source number, don't worry about it. That's probably just from the cropping. And I think that pretty much covers everything here, except to just remind you, if you're using Windows, make sure that any adjustments that you've made, make sure you check out a preview to make sure that what you think is happening is actually happening before you go and encode your entire video.